Software. It powers our life, our phones, our homes, even what we spend our lifetime is determined by algorithms. But there is a silent crisis going on behind every software system out there that most people don't think about because it is invisible. It spreads among millions of lines of code. Its name is software bloat. Software bloat is a real problem. I know this very well because I spent 5 years of my PhD trying to understand this phenomenon and finding novel ways to mitigate it. If you think about it, it is crazy that today's software system needs millions of lines of code, gigabytes of disk space and memory just to open a web page in a browser. And indeed, the latest version of Google Chrome has more than 7 million lines of code. And Chrome is nowadays part of practically every single mobile device out there. I still remember when I was a child in the 90s when I installed Windows XP from a CD-ROM with less than 700 megabytes. However, the latest version of Windows, which I think is 11, it weighs more than 20 gigabytes today. So I would have needed like 30 CD-ROM to store the latest Windows there. And my question is really the latest Windows 30 times better? I doubt it. So what causes this overwhelming software bloat situation? What are its implications? And what is more important, what can we do about it? In this video, we will address these questions from a scientific and practical perspective. And at the end, we will come up with answers based on what I have learned during my years doing research on this topic. So let's dive in. To understand software bloat, we have to travel back in time, in the early days of computing. Code was lean back then, heavily optimized and crafted with precision because computing resources such as memory and CPU were quite limited. For example, the entire code base of the Apollo mission written by a team of MIT software engineers led by Margaret Hamilton was only around 145,000 lines of assembly code. And this code had to run on a computer with 64 kilobytes of memory. And this is 1 million times smaller than the amount of RAM I have right now in my personal computer that I am using to record this video. But as technology evolved, our approach to software development also changed. In the 70s, software was often handcrafted for a specific task. Hardware was a precious resource, and every byte was important. But today, thanks to Moore's law, holding for so many years since the 1975, computational power is way cheaper. And as a result, we have got very complex software projects that measure their code bases in millions of lines of code and consume a huge amount of resources. From what we have seen, hardware becomes faster and cheaper at the same rate that software becomes slower and more expensive. But apart from better and cheaper hardware, what else causes this explosion? There are several reasons. First, I think the expectations of software users have increased dramatically in the last decades. And this led to the rise of feature-rich applications capable of handling more complex tasks. And the increase of data that needs to be processed has also increased dramatically. On the other end, the software development teams need to adapt to the increasing demand for software and in the pressure to deliver solutions quickly. And this leads to the proliferation of software frameworks and the availability of reusable components, which we call software dependencies. And the integration of these third-party libraries and software pieces is one of the primary causes of bloat. And indeed, today, we can pull in from a remote server to our local computer, thousands of dependencies at the click of a button. These dependencies are hosted in software repositories And in fact, we have no idea where exactly this comes from. It actually blows my mind, the idea that we don't really know who is in control of these large repositories of software artifacts, such as npm for JavaScript, PyPy for Python, or Maven for Java. And don't get me wrong, software reuse is indeed a great idea. It increases productivity by reducing cycles of development time, which in the end contribute to saving costs. But the advantages of code reuse come at a cost, and sometimes it becomes a double-edged sword. And software bloat is the typical example, but it is not the only one. Software reuse also creates unnecessary complex and often even unsafe software, because it increases the attack surface. It is interesting to me the fact that these days software is considered so critical that we are told not to run it ourselves. Instead, we are supposed to use a SaaS provider for almost everything. Need an email service? You should not implement it yourself. Need a payment solution? You should use a third-party service. Need to train the machine learning model? Well, you should use an MLOps provider. And by the way, everything nowadays should run on the cloud, right? Servers that managed by some multinational company. So in essence, years of cloud advocacy have made us believe that the cloud is somehow able to make software more stable and trustworthy. But in reality, I believe that the cloud is just another layer of complexity to our already highly bloated systems. So let's have a look at a real world example. Consider a modern home. A simple task like opening a garage door might involve running an application built on a framework like Electron.js, for example, which incorporates Chromium, provides access to tens of thousands of software packages for JavaScript. And that is potentially over 50 million lines of code in total if you include dependencies, which will put in 40 dependencies that are necessary to build the garage app. This explosion of transitive dependencies is called dependency hell. But it gets even worse if we consider that today we ship software as containers. And this means that what it is included itself is also operating system to make sure that it runs in a well-known environment. And this again expands the amount of code being deployed. And today there is a lot of Docker images with hundreds of megabytes being constantly pulled from places like Docker Hub. So what it is included in the build can change on a daily basis, ending up in a situation in which no one could really know what it is inside. So why is so much code necessary to build something so simple? The reason lies in the layers of abstraction put on top over another. Operating systems, frameworks, package managers, dependencies, and so on. So what used to be done by a few hundred lines of well-crafted code now relies on entire ecosystems of software. It is like building a house on top of another house, which is on top of another house, and each layer adds complexity and potential issues. And the more layers we have, the more disconnected we become from the original problem that we are trying to solve. Software bloat isn't just a matter of efficiency, it is also a big deal for security. The more code we have, the more vulnerabilities we introduce. In a study made by Denise, code reviews found that in average of between 7 and 12 vulnerabilities per 1,000 lines of code. And the problem grows proportionally to the size of the companies. So you don't need a high bug density to find an exploitable hole in millions of lines of code. For example, iPhone users got hacked over many years because of a huge attack surface exposed in iMessage. In this case, the attacker sent an unsolicited iMessage to an Apple user, and the phone will then immediately process that message so that the user can revive it. And the problem is that the Apple decided to support many image formats and accidentally including PDF with some strange embedding fonts that include the programming language. So attackers could send an unsolicited message to your iPhone and benefit from this security bug, which, by the way, was present somewhere in the millions of lines of code in the iPhone. So that being said, Apple is by far not the worst offender in this field, but it is still interesting to know that even respected companies fall into the trap of allowing too many features, causing something known as feature creep. In 1995, the computer scientist Niklaus Wirth warned us of this problem. In his article, A Player of Lean Software, he described this problem very clearly. He advocated for simplicity, efficiency, and most importantly, restraint in software design, highlights how advancements in hardware performance, such as faster processors and larger memory capacities, have paradoxically led to lazier software development practices. Developers often assume that more powerful hardware will compensate for inefficient software, leading to a vicious cycle where software demands more from hardware, which is in turn drives hardware advancements, perpetuating software inefficiency. To some, complexity equals power. Increasingly, people seem to misinterpret complexity as sophistication, which is baffling. The incomprehensible show cause suspicion rather than admiration. So that quote is very true today. Interestingly, it was sad back then because the software had grown to megabytes in size. But today, some projects have megabytes in configuration files alone. So the core message of this paper is clear. Complexity should be treated with suspicions, not admiration. But unfortunately, it seems that the software industry has largely moved into the opposite direction. I strongly recommend you to read this paper if you have not done so yet. I will let you the link in the description of this video. So, what can we do about it? The good news is that not only the software development community, but even governments are taking this problem very, very seriously. There are currently many initiatives been implemented to fight back against software bloat. Like, for example, the European Union has recently introduced legislation to make companies list their software bill of materials. This is a necessary step, like to, first of all, have a better knowledge of the software that we are shipping to our customers. And these initiatives have at the international level, could significantly improve software security and reduce bloat at large. But legislation alone won't solve the problem. It requires a cultural shift within the software industry itself. Eventually, the issue of software bloat might push companies to prioritize leaner, more secure code. So, first, I believe it starts with discipline. As developers, we should prioritize simplicity and efficiency, choosing leaner tools and libraries and avoiding unnecessary dependencies. Second, we need to rethink our approach to software architecture. For example, instead of building monolithic apps, we can break down functionality into smaller, more easily to manage components, each designed to do one thing and only one thing very, very well. This approach, known as microservices, helps to combat complexity and allow for easier maintenance and scalability. However, even here, we must take it carefully. Lean development patterns and microservices are not silver bullets. Indeed, as we know, when it comes to software development, there is no silver bullet. Breaking down functionality too much can introduce its own forms of bloat if not managed correctly. In particular, sometimes it is better to provide a standalone software that does not really use any external service. So only a deep understanding of the pros and cons of each design option could lead to the best architectural decision. So in summary, we need to advocate for a culture where quality matters more than quantity of features, where the performance of an application is valued as one of its more important features. So let's imagine a future where software is once again lean, efficient, and trustworthy, where apps do what they are supposed to do, no more, no less. Projects like React, RabVM, and Docker Slim show us that it is possible. These alternative stacks are very tiny. They allow for the bloating software into self-contained image solutions. In other words, there are alternatives that prove that you don't need to ship a bloated framework to build something useful and secure. These are small steps, but at least they are steps in the right direction. So if more developers embrace this mindset, we could start to reverse the trend of software bloat. But we are still very far from the simplicity of the past. But that doesn't mean that we cannot return. It is time to take a hard look at the software we build and ask ourselves, can we do it better? So, as I have mentioned, software bloat isn't just a technical issue. It is a challenge to our entire approach to technology. But with awareness, discipline, and a commitment to change, we can build a future where software is leaner, more secure, and simply better. So, coming back to Wirth, as he once said, the plague of software explosion is not a lack of nature. It is avoidable, and it is the software engineer's task to curtail. The question is, are you up for the challenge? Bloat and complexity are, I believe, today's software biggest vulnerabilities. See you in the next one. Bye.